This plant is mock orange, also known as syringa, and the flowers, when they come out later, they're so incredibly fragrant. They're absolutely amazing. And a friend of mine at one point, he took some of the flowers and he pretended to eat some, and he said, "Oh, have you tasted these? They're amazing. You should try this." So of course I did. No. They're one of the most disgusting tasting things around. Don't eat the flowers. They're not edible. But this is a very useful plant as a tool, because it's one of the plants that is very good for doing handrails. So you can cut a shaft like this, straighten it pretty easily, and using that on a board of cedar or alder root or clematis vine, cottonwood or cottonwood root, and very effective for a handrail. There's a bit of variation. Sometimes you've got a thicker wall to the stem, and then there's a pith to it. Sometimes you have a thicker pith and a thinner wall to it, and so you might have to play around with which particular syringa growing in which conditions is going to give you the best handrail shaft, but this is a good species to look at. For that same reason, it also is very good for arrow shafts. It's a very, very hard wood on the outside of the pith. And I've even used it for making needles for sewing together mats out of cattail or bulrush. And behind me over here, it is wild rose, and roses are totally edible, and they're pretty good. So it's a nice little nibble to munch on the roses here, and they are mildly astringent and as well as antibiotics. So if someone had an eye injury or something as an infection in their eye, this is the plant that I would use. I would harvest the rose petals and make a tea out of that, cool it down to around body temperature, and then use that to rinse the eye. Use it as frequently as you need until finally the infection or whatever the issue is clears up. A good plant to know.
What once, is astringent?
Astringent means that it kind of draws out a little bit. When you eat something that's astringent, your mouth goes dry. So mildly astringent. And then once the rose hips are produced, then you can eat the rose hips. If you wait until the rose hips have gone through a couple of freeze-thaw cycles, they become really soft and they sweeten. And they're really tasty, very, very high in vitamin C, and they're a delicious tea. So you gather the soft rose hips that have frozen and thawed a number of times, mash them up, and pour boiling water on them. Yummy, yummy. Good stuff. Ah, what did you find over there? That looks to me like...
That's not clematis, it's a
wine. No, that's not clematis, that's the honeysuckle.
Honeysuckle.
Yeah.
Okay.
So honeysuckle is a hummingbird pollinated plant, so it has those very long flowers and it has sugar at the back end of it, which is why they're so nice to pick the flowers off and just bite off the ends of the flower. Harvest honeysuckle vines to make into baskets. So you've got the southern interior BC one. Now this tree is Cascara, and we're just at the northern edge of the range of Cascara here on the border of the US and Canada. And Cascara has a long history of being used as a laxative. The way that it's used is the bark is harvested and then the bark is dried for a long period of time, a year or two, until it's not quite so strong.
and then teas are made out of it, and then it works well as a laxative. This also produces a blackberry, which is edible for people. With caution, I wouldn't try to make that your sole source of food, because you may find that it works as a bit of a laxative too. But as something to nibble on, absolutely, they're good to eat. And the bears definitely like them.
The clematis, it's got the beautiful wild purple flower, and it's a vine. And here's like the old vine, you can see it.
This is clematis. Clematis grows as a vine, and in this area it has a faint light blue flower. And clematis that I find that grows lower elevation gets much bigger around than what this vine will. And so I've found vines that are up to about that big around, and those are the ones that I like to use for a board for a hand drill. Otherwise, it is mildly poisonous. It's a skin irritant. So even though this is a vine and it may look like, oh, we could use that as rope or we could use it to make baskets, I recommend against it, because you can get a skin rash on your hands from handling this, getting the juices on your hands. This is another good plant to know for both a medicine and as a tool. This is ocean spray, and when the flowers are fresh and in bloom, these are last year's flowers, they're bright white, and with a bit of imagination, it looks like the caps of waves out on the water, so ocean spray. And ocean spray, gathering these flowers when they're fresh and white, drying them, it makes a very mild stimulant to the antibiotic system, which is excellent for children. So children, and you're thinking, oh, it seems like there's colds going around, this is a good tea for them. Once these flowers are dry like this, of course it just rained, so these aren't really dry, but these are really nice and fluffy and good to mix up to use for a tinder bundle to blow into a flame. And then it's a very, very tough wood. So if we looked around in here, we could probably find some nice arrow shafts. That's all I've ever used it for, is for arrow shaft material. But anything that you need a really hard wood for, this is very good. The one thing that I found in making arrow shafts from this is the wood splits very easily. So whenever I've harvested it in the summertime, I've always ended up with cracks in the wood, no matter how I've tried to dry it slowly. So I only gather this one for arrow shafts in the winter.
Mm. Is a tiger lily you're touching with your arm there?
Yes, you're right. So we'll do this one too.
It's about to bloom.
So this is a tiger lily, and here are the flower pods that haven't quite opened up yet. Tiger lilies have an edible root, which best to boil or steam. And of course, if you dig up the roots, you kill the plant. So whenever we're dealing with something like that, it's always good to really be conscious of ethical harvesting. It's pretty easy if you were to make a concerted effort to get a big meal of tiger lilies that you would kill off a lot of the population in the area. So, you know, if you wanted to try it out sometime and you look around and you notice there are a lot of tiger lilies around, then that's a possibility, or if you're in a real survival situation. But otherwise, this is one that's a good one to just appreciate beautiful flowers later on.
Ready?
So this is a species of violet here, and the violets are all edible, so they're a very nice addition to salads. Later on, they'll have either a yellow or a purple flower, and the flowers are edible too. Nice little nibble alongside the trail.
Pretty good for menstrual problems too, isn't it?
This plant is poison ivy.
Oh, so, okay.
Three leaves coming out, leaves of three, let it be. Poison ivy has an oil that, if you get it onto your skin, causes those nasty rashes to occur. And because it's an oil, it can last for a long time on your clothing, for instance, before you actually get it. And sometimes what people will do is they'll walk through poison ivy and they will continually reinfect themselves with or reapply that oil to themselves until they finally take their clothing and wash it. So the best thing for you to do if you encounter poison ivy is go home and wash with soap and get the oil off of you. There's one plant in particular that's really good for treating poison ivy, and unfortunately it's an eastern variety. It's called jewelweed, and we don't have that around here, but it's fantastic for treating poison ivy. Out here you could crush up or run through a juicer the plantain, and that will help to soothe your skin. But the first order of business is just get the oils away from you so that you're not reapplying it.
It's best to use like a really lye-based soap, like ivory, because I don't know how many patients mm-hmm. I've had that get poison ivy and then they put some kind of like lotion on, and that just spreads the oil out on the surface tension of the lotion, and it just keeps like spreading across their body. And it's like, well, you can use the calamine stuff to keep it still, and then you got to get it off of there. But
I've
seen people just like a bushfire.
Yeah. So that's a very good point. Use a strong soap that's going to actually remove the oils and not a lotion soap that's going to spread the oils. People have varying degrees of sensitivity to it. Please don't think that because you haven't gotten poison ivy yet and you've been around it that you're immune to it, because it probably isn't going to work that way for you. I know people who grew up around poison ivy, lots of it when they were kids, and they rolled around in it, never got poison ivy, but eventually reached that tipping point in the body where now going around poison ivy, this one friend of mine, he's wearing gloves and his whole body is covered. It's like he's going into a nuclear reactor scene. So you can get very, very sensitive to it over time through continuous exposure. Wheat Sicily, and besides just the overall look of the plant, it's very easy to know this one just by tasting it and smelling it. It's got a licorice or anise taste to it. It's delicious. And what I normally do is later on in the summer, it produces their seeds, and I'll munch on the seeds. Just chew on a couple of them as a breath mint sort of a thing. They're just a lovely taste to them. The whole plant is edible, even the root, but just taking a few seeds here and there doesn't disturb anything, or disturb very much. I believe it's used as a stimulant to the immune system, but I have never used it, and I can't recall if that's exactly true or not, so I'm just going to say that this is witch's butter. Standing here beside a couple of birch trees. And birch is useful for a couple of different things. Certainly birch is good for the bark. And one thing that the bark is really good for is starting fires. And this is the kind of bark that you want to get for starting your fires. This is very, very thin and very papery. And even though it's been raining, it's still incredibly flammable because it has oils in it that light regardless of what the rain's done. So even when it's wet, birch is really good for lighting. So I always make sure I have some birch bark in my fire kit so that regardless of the conditions, once I get a flame, I know that I can keep a flame going. Another thing that the birch bark is used for is making baskets. So a fantastic source for basket material. The way that birch bark grows on it, very different from the bark from most trees, the orientation of the grain is running in a spiral around it like this. So unlike many trees, I can't just make a cut in it
Like, for instance, if I was stripping off cedar bark, I could make a cut down at the base of it, grab a hold of it, and actually pull and rip the bark off that way, getting strips that are 20 plus feet long. I can't do that with birch. So I have to make sure I make a very precise cut all the way down and then peel it off this way around it and take it off in a panel like that. That panel then I can take, fold the edges up, make a very quick basket, take me no time at all to have something to eat out of or even something to cook out of if I wanted to use hot stones. Birch bark was used for making canoes. You can make a very quick cup or a spoon out of the bark from the birch. And it's also very good for firewood if it's really, really dry. So out here in the woods, it seems like it's never dry enough to just use it as is. So it's a good one to cut early in the season and then store and dry it so that you have dry wood for later on. And one more thing about the birch tree is that the sap from it is edible. So in the springtime, in this area, we don't have the sugar maple like occurs out in the east. So the maple trees that we have out here mostly are either very small, like the Rocky Mountain maple, or they're larger maples with a sap that's not as sweet. So the sugar maple has a ratio of 40 to 1, so 40 liters of sap to produce 1 liter of syrup. With some of the maples that we have in this area, it's closer to 100 to 1. The Rocky Mountain maple seems to be about 40 to 1, but it's a very small species. The birch is about 80 to 1, and there's lots and lots of birch around here. So you can render that down just the same as you would with the maples and produce a really nice sweet syrup.